Part 3, Balanced Wire. This stemmed from another audio tech. When a customer wanted to install guitar lines but used normal snake cable to do it, the tech responded, "If you want to lose all your tone." So what are we talking about here? In the audio world, in a way, you can break most cables down to three categories: balanced, unbalanced, and speaker cables. We're not concerned with speaker cables here, so let's get that one out of the way. A speaker cable will normally be an unshielded pair of wires, normally a heavier gauge. The key there is the unshielded aspect of it. You just don't normally need shielding for speaker cables, but you do with other cables, and so speaker cables don't qualify in this test. The two wires we are concerned about are balanced and unbalanced. A balanced cable consists of a twisted pair of conductors and a shield, and an unbalanced cable consists of a single center conductor with a shield around it. A balanced cable has three conductors, including the shield, and an unbalanced has two conductors, including the shield. Guitars in most cases use unbalanced cable, with the center conductor being the signal and the shield being the shield and the signal ground. To recap from test one, we know that low impedance output is better for tone with a longer cable, and that from test two, a thicker cable performs better, but it might be because of a lower capacitance. All that was based on standard guitar wiring with unbalanced wire. So let's put balanced wire in the mix and see what happens. For this test, we're going to use four wires for comparison. We're looking at Mogami 2524, the high-end instrument cable, and comparing it to Mogami 2549, the high-end mic cable. These two are similar in overall size and cost. The other two we will compare are Mogami 2319, the medium-grade instrument cable, and comparing it to Mogami snake cable, like 2930. The snake cable was a bit lighter than 2319, but the main object of this test is to test snake cable with instruments. First, let's look at the wire specs so we know what we're comparing. All our specs are going to be at 50 feet. 2319, the center conductor is 1 ohm. The shield conductor is 0.395 ohm. The capacitance from shield to conductor is 2,365 picofarad. Mogami 2524, the center conductor is 0.5 ohm. The shield resistance is 0.215 ohm. The capacitance to the shield is 1,985 picofarad. Mogami 2549, one of the center conductor resistances is 1.35 ohms. The shield resistance is 0.1 ohms. The capacitance to shield is 1,300 picofarads. The capacitance between the two center conductors is 155 picofarad. Mogami snake wire conductor resistance is 1.68 ohms. The shield resistance is 0.475 ohms. The capacitance from a conductor to a shield is 2,135 picofarad. The capacitance between conductor is 185 picofarad. First, let's go to the computer simulated test. We're basically using the same method as the first two tests, but we're adding a test for the balanced cable. So the top circuit is an unbalanced cable, just as before, and the new bottom circuit is a balanced cable. This section represents the unbalanced wire, and this section represents the balanced wire. Looking at the balanced wire, these lines represent the two main conductors, with R14 and R9 being the wire resistance, and C11 being the conductor-to-conductor capacitance. These lines represent the shield, and C14 and C6 fill the role of conductor-to-shield capacitance. Don't worry, you don't need to get every little detail of this. The results are what's important here. I just need to show this so that those that understand what's going on can question the results if they feel the need to. We're going to keep the 50,000 ohm output impedance and the 1 mega ohm input impedance for all tests because that best fits the application we are simulating and shows the problem we are trying to test. Most instruments are unbalanced, so they only need two conductors, the center conductor and the shield or ground. So to this point, one test covers it. But now with balanced cable, it has three conductors, a center pair, and a shield, so there are several ways the connections can be made. Standard wiring practice has you tie the low and the shield or ground together, so essentially the low conductor becomes part of the shield, shown here. This will be referred to as low to ground wiring. The other way it can be wired is to tie and use it like one larger conductor, shown here. We will refer to this as conductor tied wiring. I should point out that the high and low conductors are identical, except the color. So there's no difference with high to ground wiring, as long as you don't wire the connectors like that too. So then let's jump to the results. To my amazement, the 2549 low to ground performs the best. The red line is 2549 with low tied to ground. The green line is 2524. The blue line is 2549 with the two conductors tied together. When you tie the two conductors together, you end up combining the conductor to shield capacitance from each line and end up with the highest shield to conductor capacitance. So the results show with the worst response. It also helps prove that the higher capacitance is the bigger problem in our wire size test. Essentially, tying the two wires together doubles the wire size, but it does not perform better. Same test with 2319 and Megami snake wire. In this case, the snake wire with low tied to ground and 2319 perform almost identically with the green and brown lines. The red line is a snake with the two conductors tied together and performs the worst. To compare them all in order from best to worst would be 2549 low to ground, then 2524, then all about equal is snake low to ground, 2319, 2549 conductors tied, and the worst would be snake conductors tied. Just a quick note, from best to worst, they are in order of lowest capacitance to highest capacitance. Okay, let's move on to the real world test. Same test as earlier, we're using computer software and a quality sound card. A simulated load of a 50 kilo ohm output impedance through the wire and into a high input impedance of a preamp. We'll be using 50 feet of wire just like the other tests. And the results are about the same. I love it when science works. So the red line is 2549 with low to ground. The blue line is 2524. And the green line is 2549 with the conductors tied. Just for the fun of it, I ran one more test. The white line, it is 2549 with only high conductor and the shield. The low conductor is unattached at both ends. For all extensive purposes, it is the same. By zooming way in, I would say it's about 0.2 dB higher at 10 kHz. Next we have 2319 and snake cable. I kept the red line from the last test for reference. So it is 2549 with low to ground. The green line is a snake wire with low to ground, and the blue line is 2319. These are really close. The snake wire came out a hair better than the simulation. And the white line is a snake with conductors tied, and as expected, came out the worst. All right, now let's do our guitar test. Just like before, I'm feeding the signal into a guitar by way of an electromagnet and then running through the cable to the preamp. At this point, I feel confident with the balanced cable and the conductors tied method. It is a bad idea. So to simplify, I'm going to eliminate that from the rest of the tests. So here are the results. This one has a baseline test. The yellow line is 1 foot of 2524. From there, the red line is 50 feet of 2549 with low to ground. The green line is 2524. The white line is snake wire with low tied to ground. And the blue line is 2319. Those fall all in order of lowest capacitance to highest capacitance. All right, that completes the test for this video. To summarize, input and output impedance. Regarding tone and cable length, the input impedance has little effect, but the output impedance has a large effect. The higher the output impedance, the more high-end loss you will see with longer cables. When it comes to cable size, the larger cables did perform better. When it came to unbalanced cable or balanced cable, regarding tone again, the driving force seemed to be capacitance, with balanced cable beating all others because it had the lowest capacitance. From just these results, I would not see a big problem sending a guitar signal down a snake, though for a long run, other considerations might need to be taken. Warning. This was a test looking strictly at tone and frequency response of the cables in the various applications. There may be other factors, including shielding, noise pickup, handling noise, etc. There are also different input and output designs that may perform differently under different conditions. This video is to simply provide a basis of how these cables may perform, and in reality, results may vary. I hope to continue with this and make a series of videos to look at other aspects of cables, like handling noise, noise pickup, etc., and build upon this to form a more complete look at how cables interact in the environment. Please like and share and follow to stay up with all our videos. Thanks for watching. Please leave questions and comments below, and I'll try to address them.